Well, today we're going to talk a bit more about classroom management and some tips and techniques for creating a peaceful classroom, for normalizing your students as quickly as possible to get on with the work at hand. Elaine Palmore is with me today, and Elaine has, I'm going to let her actually talk about her background, but she is a staff member of Island Village Montessori and is the principal of our elementary program. And Elaine, you want to talk a little bit about your experience in terms of, you know, classroom management and what you've been doing?
I started teaching Montessori in 1975 because my kids got involved. I taught at a private school. It was in a building, and we had like 40 children. We had an upstairs and a downstairs, and the children could go anywhere they wanted to. And of course, the children, either all 40 of them were downstairs or all 40 of them were upstairs. So we had to put math and practical life in the downstairs, and then had to put the other subjects upstairs that went together. I taught preschool there for a long time, about 10 years, 15 years. And then I taught in a public school, taught at Hull Jackson in Nashville, Tennessee, taught first through fourth grade, a gifted class. And then I came here, and I've been here for, this is my fifth year. I taught first, second, and third grade the first year, and then moved up with the children. It's been a wonderful experience. Taught all the subjects last year. It was a very different year with the big fifth graders than it was, the first year.
And one of the things about Elaine that she's noted for is her beautiful environment. So I've asked Elaine to talk to all of you a little bit about what she's learned over the years and why she designs her environments the way she does, and how really it affects and impacts student learning. So we're going to talk about practical life right now. And as elementary, in an elementary training program, sometimes practical life is not talked about as deeply as it probably should be, because the emphasis is more on the curriculum as far as reading, writing, and arithmetic. But in a Montessori environment, especially where we're looking at how do we make children independent, how do we not have the teacher involved and in charge all the time and telling people what to do, how do we create that environment to encourage that independence where students aren't going to just misbehave or not pay attention? Or, you know, what are some suggestions, especially in relation right now to the practical life? What is practical life, Elaine?
I think that practical life should be the beginning and the end of every Montessori classroom. I think in the lower grades, it is even in kindergarten, it's where you need to start. The beginning of the year needs to be just one formal lesson after the other with the practical life materials. If you have a polishing exercise, for instance, have everything there, have the Q-tips there, have the polish there in tiny containers, not gallon jugs of that you can just swish around, but have everything in a manageable portion for that activity on the shelf. And when the children come in, first day, they will look at that, and it Montessori says it speaks to them, and they are intrigued by the color, they are intrigued by the color and the texture of the of the polish. They are intrigued by either the silver piece that's being polished or the wood, or later on the pairs of shoes. But it's I call it in this paper that I've written, I call it the great tranquilizer, because it really helps the children to calm down. Big washing exercises do the same thing. If you have a little basket again, with everything in it that you're going to need, a spray bottle, a sponge, a little cleaner. Have everything the child needs in that little basket, and they can go around and clean, you know, clean the tables. Window washing is something else. They can do the same thing. Again, have a spray bottle, the sponge, the towel. But give formal lessons in the beginning of how to use that material and what the sequence is of that, and make sure that they follow that sequence. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't pour the water into the bucket, you know, at the beginning of the thing because you have no water. Mm-hmm. But after you do the initial presentation, they will learn that. And it's just wonderful. And people will be lined up wanting to take a turn. Mm-hmm.
So what is it about this that's so calming? Why is practical life so calming for the students?
Maria Montessori calls it purposeful movement. And I don't know if you have it, but I do. Sewing is purposeful movement. You know, mm-hmm. you're doing it with your hands. You're washing the dishes. I remember my mother and I had our very best conversations, although when they got heated, it got a little, you know, the dishes really got washed. But it's just a way of calming down, of moving, you know, moving your hands in a circle if you're washing something. It's just the most peaceful, you know, it's just the most peaceful way to be. And in most schools you can tell where practical life is because that's the area with the linoleum. Mm-hmm. You know, and you can make the mess. Mm-hmm. And you have the natural consequences there. If you get through with your table washing exercise and you pour the dirty water into the bucket and decide that you want to run from the table mm-hmm. to the sink with the bucket, there's going to be a natural consequence. Mm-hmm. You're going to trip and fall, and the water's going to go everywhere. Or by the same token, if you're getting the water for an exercise to pour in this beautiful bowl that you have arranged there, if you run or if somebody bumps into you, there is a natural consequence. Mm-hmm. Everything spills, things break. And when I taught preschool, I had the whole thing, it was glass. The pitcher was glass, the bowl was mm-hmm. glass, you know, the bucket was right under the table, everything matched, and I, for a nice touch, I put a little vase with a little flower on it, and it was perfect. Mm-hmm. It was really beautiful.
So that the normalizing of the act, of the material, of the action, and so talk about as far as how do you use practical life in your classroom design overall? How do you use that philosophy of purposeful work?
In the very beginning, it's a huge part of the day. A big part of the classroom is set up for practical life. When you get into second and third and fourth grade, the size of the practical life area decreases as the year goes on because, you know, if you don't want people washing a table all day long every day. But it's an integral part of the classroom because once the children get into the habit of taking care of the environment and taking care of themselves and cleaning up after themselves, it just becomes natural. And they do it every day at lunch. You know, if they sit in the classroom and have their lunch, or even if there's a cafeteria, you know, you have teams of folks who are doing practical mm-hmm. life, cleaning it, you know, mm-hmm. cleaning it up. And I've found that practical life for the younger children is a way to get them integrated into a routine and into how things flow in the classroom. In the older children, if they are involved in some big math project, some academic project, practical life is a wonderful place to go and calm mm-hmm. down. Mm-hmm. You know, you can just go and spoon some beans. Mm-hmm. You know, the regularity of it, mm-hmm. it's just, and you know, the sound of the beans, and you know these beans, and you're familiar with these beans,
like,
and
a
it
meditating.
Makes you feel good. It really
yes.
is. It's yes. like meditating. Exactly.
Yeah.
yeah. It's
finding your center,
I think. It is finding
you
your
say?
Center.
Yes.
Right. And I've had actual meditation in the practical mm-hmm. life area with the pillows mm-hmm. and, you know, the music, the headphones mm-hmm. if you need it, you know. And I have said to children, I think you need to go over into the practical life area mm-hmm. and calm yourself down. And, you know, mm-hmm. it's a wonderful thing.
So we're teaching independence.
We're teaching independence.
Contribution to the classroom, to right. the environment.
Waiting a turn.
Mm-hmm. Waiting your turn.
Sequencing.
Mm-hmm. Well, to go back to that in a second, the other thing seems to be this idea that the environment and the way it looks is important. That just having, you know, stuff laying all over the place, not pushing in your chair, being okay with papers thrown all over the place and pencils just laying on the ground, you know, it hopefully starts to give the students a sense of, you know, this is my space. I don't want it to look like that. I don't want it to be ugly. I don't want there to be marks all over the wall.
Right.
I don't want the door to look like there's fingerprints everywhere. Or
right.
And hopefully, how does that impact their work?
It impacts it immediately. Let's back up just a little bit to the way the environment looks. I had a director tell me once, I put out this beautiful tea set. You know, Montessorians have to have tea sets in their practical life area because they have to, you know, just have all the little things that are right and they match. And, you know, you can set the table with them or whatever. And after about the first hour of the day, there were two pieces of it that were broken. And I was heartbroken. I was just hysterical because I just thought this would be the very thing. And so I took these broken pieces, and I was broken at that point, and I went upstairs and I said to the director, look, this is beautiful. This is broken, and it was so beautiful, and I thought they'd love it. And she said, you know what? The way you have that presented does not say, treat me gently. Mm. And that's a direct quote from Montessori. The work needs to say, look at me. Mm-hmm. And treat me gently. And that worked. The way I had it presented, mm-hmm. I had it presented in a little tin thing or something. Mm-hmm. And it didn't say that. Mm-hmm. So I pulled it off the mm-hmm. shelf, redid it, put a doily in there and had it set up in a different way, and it lasted the rest of the year. Mm-hmm. So it was my fault. Mm-hmm. And I think teachers need to do that sometimes. Look at themselves and say, is this not working because I don't have it set up properly? Mm-hmm. Does it not say touch me gently? Mm-hmm. Is it not, you know, is it not attractive? Mm-hmm. I've seen people with mats that go under underwater work, and the mats are brown plastic mm-hmm. utility mats of some kind. Well, you don't want to do that. Mm-hmm. And I also said in that paper, colored water, mm-hmm. it's like magic. Mm-hmm. I mean, who would not love blue water,
right.
you know? And the blue water on the shelf, on a blue tray mm-hmm. with a blue sponge, it's a picture. Mm-hmm. It looks perfect. It looks, you know, it looks beautiful. And it says, come and try me out. Mm-hmm. Touch me gently.
Yes.
You know, move me around. And while they're moving that water with a syringe mm-hmm. or with an eyedropper, mm-hmm. they're developing that pincer grip that they're going to need to write. And of course, in the Montessori classroom, everything begins from left to right, mm-hmm. and it teaches them left to right orientation mm-hmm. as well.
The touch me gently is so important. I know in my training, we kept hearing over and over again. Excuse me, having things like an art gallery where you would walk in and especially in a museum where you notice there's obviously this very expensive building, but they might just have one or two paintings on an entire wall, you know, this kind of minimalist look to it. But what it did is it immediately, you got the impression that this was a valuable piece of work, because if it wasn't, they would have had 20, you know, paintings on the wall. So the idea is not to just shove everything out,
right?
But to very carefully place things so that there is that sense of, this is important, that treat me gently, this means something, it's meaningful. And the care of the environment by the students as well as the educators, where they're taking time to clean up, they're taking time to sharpen the pencils, they're making sure that the supply shelf is stocked, that the students don't have to go looking around for things, that the students know how to replace things in the supply shelf, that it's something that everybody cares about,
right.
is not is not something you do when you have time. It's a priority. It's
absolutely every day.
Basic priority. And to have a shelf where you've got papers all over, strewn all over, you've got materials half, you know, the box is not even, the lid of the box isn't even on there, something stacked on top of something else that shouldn't be. That's exactly telling the children, don't care about me.
Exactly.
Who cares?
Exactly.
I'm just going to throw it back wherever I feel like, and the educator, the teacher's okay with it, so what the heck? And how much that really detracts from being able to have a group of independent students and normalizing the whole process of normalization. It just won't happen. And that very simple act of how do you put something back? How do you take it off? Make sure that things aren't scratched up. If something's missing, they're replaced. The whole nine
and
yards.
And that they match.
And they match, yes.
They don't have to be silk. Mm-hmm. They don't have to be crystal. But you can put silk and crystal out. Mm-hmm. When I was doing my elementary training with the Miss Charming and Dashing Mr. Gary Davison, I said to him that I had in my classroom a tray with stemmed glasses that the children used the water, the glasses with water in them to walk around the circle and develop grace and courtesy and balance. And I mean, you could go on and on and on about the attributes. And he said, no, you do not. And I said, yes, I do. And he came here, and there was a piece of Waterford crystal on this tray that had the magic colored water in it. And if you, when you were demonstrating how to walk around the circle, pick up that beautiful Waterford crystal like it's the most beautiful thing you've ever seen. Mm. And if you as the teacher, walk around the circle with that in that reverent way, the children will do the same thing. Mm-hmm. And of course, if they don't, again, you have the natural consequences. You have spilled water, you have a broken, you know, you have broken glass. But that kind of thing, and the bells too, you know, I think the bells are a wonderful thing. Montessori talks about training the ear. I have a basket, even today with fourth and fifth graders, I have a basket of bells. Mm-hmm. They're all different sizes of bells, and each bell has a name, mm-hmm. and I play a game at group. I will pick up the bells on the tray and turn my back to the children and ring the bell and let them guess when I turn back around which bell I was ringing. So it can be, you know, it can be the fishing bell or it can be the school bell mm-hmm. or whatever. But the children are, you know, it's like the silence game. Mm-hmm. The children sit with just rapt attention and listen for that bell, and then they can guess, you know, which one mm-hmm. it is. And sometimes they can't hear the difference. Mm-hmm. And you know, at first you ring the bells that are very different. You have a clang, clang, clang bell, and you have a tinkle, tinkle, tinkle bell, and you turn around and you say which one is which. But then later on, you ring two bells that sound very similar to see if you are going in the right direction.
Very good.